conception through maturity, how it changes, how the bone fuses. You're studying how those structures are changing through development. Embryology. Study of developmental changes from conception to birth. So the 9 months pregnancy development. Regional anatomy, that means the study of structure within a single region, for example, the abdomen region, the neck region, the head region. Nowadays, medical schools are changing. Some medical schools are studying 1 month's anatomy, 1 month's histology, 1 month's physiology. But others, medical schools, they're studying, they're going to study everything about the head, they're going to study everything about the neck, the arm. So they study regional anatomy. So when they learn the neck, they learn the bone of the neck, muscle of the neck, nerve, blood vessel, and they go to the arm. Surface anatomy, so this is internal structure, their location related to the surface, which is the skin, and surface markings. Systemic, which we're gonna cover throughout the semester, study of structure involved with specific activity like digestion, reproduction, that means the digestive system, reproductive system. What other system do you have? Circulatory system, respiratory system, endocrine system. So all the 11 systems are studied in this systemic anatomy. I'm gonna go here. Alright, so this is how the body is organized. So if you take this building, it's got pillars, it's got cement, it's got concrete, it's got its own structure that makes it a building. The same way, this is how the human body is organized, from the smaller to the big. So let's give an example to each. Subatomic particle, what is the example of subatomic particle? Okay, proton. Proton, which is P, what is the charge? Positive, electron. P, negative, and neutron, which is no charge. Then this will organize. For example, if you take hydrogen, it has got one proton, one electron, one neutron. That becomes hydrogen. Oxygen, sodium, and so on. These are atoms. Now we have molecules. Means this has to combine to give you bigger structure. For example, okay, H2, two hydrogen atom, two oxygen atom, sodium chloride, water, carbon dioxide, and so on. Now this will organize to make what? Macromolecules. Macromolecules, what is macromolecules? We have four macromolecules in the body. Carbohydrate, lipid, protein, nucleic acid. And then this will organize to give you organelle. Organelle is the organ of the cell. So a cell has smaller functional unit that acts like an organ. Like you have a body with a stomach, heart, liver, the same thing the cell has, its own structure. So an example would be for this one. Okay, ribosome, mitochondria, nucleus, Golgi, and so forth. We'll see that in the cell discussion. And then the next structure is cell. Do you know any type of cell? Red blood cell. concept osteocyte, osteoclast, osteoblast. How about the cartilage? Cartilage set. Hyaline is a type of cartilage, but the cell inside hyaline, what do you think of? Chondrocyte. So we have up to 261 type of cells in the body, the nerve cell, and so on. And then these cells, they organize themselves to create tissue. So tissue, we have four types of tissues. Epithelial tissue, connective tissue, the other two, nervous, and muscle. So the next structure will be organ. That means it will have a combination of this tissue. That has, okay, stomach, heart, that skin, okay, the pancreas, and so forth. So they will have epithelial tissue, connective tissue, nerve tissue, and muscle. And this will organize itself into the digestive system, the reproductive system, which is the organ system. 11 organ systems. And those organ systems will organize themselves into the full individual, which is organism. So here is the slide I passed. We'll give you different examples. How come here, skin has, you know, covering, which is epithelial tissue. It's got nerves, it's got muscle, femur. Femur, which is the big one. Organ systems. There are 11 organ systems in the body. Each system contains organ that work together. So in this case, if you take the esophagus, the stomach, the small intestine, they work together. One swallows, one breaks down the food, one absorbs. If you take the heart, it pumps blood. The blood vessel takes the blood or brings back the blood. So they work together, so that's what makes it organ system. So all organ system makes the full individual. So basically this 11 organ system is for academic understanding. That means each system, they're not independent. They are related to each other. They work together, right? Yes, you can digest food, but you need the blood vessel to take the absorbed food, right? You need the nerve to get you stop eating. So they work together. So for academic purpose, we deal with this separately. But they all work together. You cannot separate each one. So here are the different systems, like the cardiovascular system, the respiratory system, digestive system, urinary system, endocrine system. What does an endocrine system do? It sends chemical signal. That means it produces hormones. So the nervous system and the endocrine system, they regulate the other systems. They are the higher structures. So anatomy is a visual science. That means you have to see it, you have to touch it, and you have to tell the proper terminology. So use standard Buhlmann superposition comparing structure. So here is anatomy of composition. Standing erect, feet parallel, facing forward, upper limb upper side, palms facing, and the thumbs out. So the thumbs are the most lateral structure in the body. They're out. Okay. So this is how any hospital in the world or medical school or nursing school, they understand the anatomy. So when you get doctor's prescription for imaging, they use the same terminologies. Okay. Plane subsection, so the body, you can cut it this way, get right and left. You can cut it this way, get front and back. And you can cut it here, you can get up and below. But using those terms are not standard. Up, below, or front, back, there are appropriate terminologies. So, section is an actual cut, slice through structure. But plane is an imaginary flat line passing through the body. Okay. So based on that, we have this terminology. So in superior, inferior. Which section gives you superior and inferior? A transverse or a horizontal. Now you have above and below. So this is the transverse section. Anterior and posterior. That means we cut it here. Coronal section. Front and back. When do we use ventral and dorsal? For animals. And lateral. Which cut we give you, medial and lateral? So sagittal could be this, could be this, could be this. So it's cutting the body in a longitudinal section, but if it passes in the center, we call it mid sagittal because it's splitting into equal parts. Okay. Right. So, bilateral. Now, you have these two structures on both sides of the body. What is an example of bilateral structure?
Is that mid-sagittal also?
Lungs, testes.
Oh,
I don't have to. Thyroid gland is bilateral. Adrenal glands. So you use those terms, those organs with this term, ipsilateral and contralateral. Now, ipsilateral means on the same side. Contra is on the opposite. Okay? Let me give you an example. Two organs. Ipsilateral and contralateral. For example, is the liver and the heart. What is it? Are they on the same side? So contralateral, heart is on this side, liver is on this side. They're on opposite side. Okay. How many of you have seen Grey's Anatomy? Okay. So Grey's Anatomy, they had the patient with the Parkinson's disease. They put a probe into the head, right? And with the probe, so they put the probe into the right side of the brain. And they told the patient to move the hand. Which hand did it move?
Left.
The left or the right?
Left.
The left. Because the right controls the left. So the leg is contralateral to the stimulus. So the stimulus was placed on the this one responds, it will be on the same side. You see, flatter. Okay. Proximal and distal. We use this term basically for the appendages, that means for the arm and for the leg. Proximal means close to, that means the attachment. Distal is far. Okay. Now, I'm going to give you two examples, the elbow and the wrist. I want you to compare the wrist to the elbow. The wrist is distal to the elbow. Okay? Now I want you to compare the elbow to the wrist.
It's proximal.
It's proximal, so it's a relative term. Or the elbow to the biceps.
It's distal.
Elbow being distal, so it's not always proximal. Whichever is closer to this would be proximal. Whichever is far would be distal. Okay. When you use superficial and deep, this is relative to the surface. That means the top would be superficial, the inside would be deep. If you compare the brain and the skull, the brain is deep to the skull. How about the sternum and the heart? The sternum, which is the breastbone here, anterior to the heart, right? Or you can say the sternum is superficial to the heart. Okay, so this is to give you an idea. So we have a front this way and the back, which is anterior, posterior. Closer to the head is superior, and down here would be inferior. So there are alternative terminologies you can use. So superior, closer to the head. Okay, anyway. Inferior. Closer to the feet or the tail? Mm-hmm. How that? So, superior and the feet. Mm-hmm. But depending, for example, in cat, it's more appropriate to say how that. You might not have appropriate to say inferior. Comparing the cat leg, there could be you. So this is in terms of body section or plane, so it's sagittal, transverse, also called horizontal, coronal or frontal. So you can see that this is how clinical application happens. So in this case, the doctor ordered a coronal section of scanning. That means you can see the eye, the brain. So it's get this way. Here, a transverse section, so you can see if there is any hemorrhage or tumor. So it looks like there's something here. Here, you can see that this is a mid-sagittal. You can see there's some problem here. Could be concussion or some tumor. To take a further clinical application, so you can see different sections and construct this 3D image to see if there's tumor or growth inside. Now, there is a new technology, I don't know if you've seen news. You can swallow a smaller camera, and the camera takes picture and sends the picture wirelessly, and after 6 hours, the person will excrete the camera, and the picture will be constructed. And then they will see if there is colon cancer or there is some type of cross. So it's continuously capturing. So basically, all this will be constructed. So 2D image need, and then 3D image spot construct. Okay? Any questions so far? Well, there are procedures. The first thing is the person will get some kind of laxative, right? And then the person will swallow it, stay in a hospital to be captured, and then after 6 hours to be excreted, be washed in the cycle. If you've seen the guy, what's his name? Morgan, the guy who did Super Size Me. Who ate McDonald's for 30 days. Okay. So what he did was, he went to New York and went to the best physician office. He said, I want to check out everything. Okay, they checked him out. They took images and they said, your result will be back in 6 weeks. And they charged him some $10,000. Okay, so he flew to Thailand. And he stayed in 5-star hotel. He paid $3,000. He had this camera swallowed. In 2 days, he got all the results. He came back and he asked the doctor in New York, where is my result? He said, it's still in the process. So he was saying, we're behind the technology. Mm-hmm. That's his point. And then staying in 5-star hotel, and all this costed him, I think, $3,000. Okay. So you can watch this on YouTube. All right, organization of the body. So the body can be divided into two major regions. That means axia, which is the head, the neck, and the trunk, which is in the middle. And then appendages, which is appendicular, the upper and the lower limbs, the arm and the legs. So several regional terms describe area within this major division. So these terms, along with directional terms, allows accurate description of the organ. Now, you have this and this, and you can use proximal, distal, and you can divide the region, and you can specifically locate the organ. So we have cavities in the body. Right? Let's name the cavities first. So that cavities are spaces where the organ is sitting. Where do you have the cavity?
Abdomen.
Okay, thoracic cavity, you have the lung, the heart.
Pelvic.
Pelvic cavity, abdominal cavity, you have the digestive system. Brain, and here in the back. Mm-hmm. Vertebral canal, right? You have the spinal cord. So those cavities are covered with membrane, so serous membrane, line walls, structure in the anterior cavities, they make serous fluid, which reduces friction. For example, if you think about the heart, what's the normal heart rate? 60 to 100, so let's say 80 beats per minute, times 60 in 1 hour, times 24 in 1 day, right? So the heart needs fluid so that friction is less. Those membranes produce those fluid, so divided into two continuous layers. So if this is the cavity, and if this is the organ, so now we have two layers. One is covering the cavity, parietal layer. The second one is covering the organ, viscera. So this is called viscera, and this is called parietal, and this is the cavity, which has got the fluid.
Can you put the paper up a little, please?
Yes.
Thank you.
So this is the parietal layer covering the what? Covering the organ. It's visceral. Viscera means organ. Viscera is organ. Okay, let's assume this room is a cavity. There are different organs here. So what would be this shape? Viscera. And this parietal. It's the same thing. That's the same analogy. Now, what makes it difficult is to know the different cavities in the body. Okay? So, we have thoracic cavity, so we'll have thoracic membranes with the organ, visceral pleura, and parietal pleura. So there is pleural cavity and pericardial cavity. So in the pericardium, what's peri means? Around. Around. Cardium. That means this cavity surrounds the heart. So if this is the heart, and this is the cavity, how do you call this one surrounding the viscera? Pericardium. And this one? Parietal? Pericardium. Now the fluid? Theory, cardia, fluid. Okay. And then the next one is the lung, right? Now you have the thoracic cavity, which is called pleural cavity. So there is a membrane that covers this. And there is a membrane that covers the wall. Now, what do you call the cavity where the lung is at? Pleura, right? So now, what would be this one? Viscera, pleura. And this would be? Parietal pleura. And the fluid? Pleura. So in the thoracic cavity, you have the pericardial cavity and pleural cavity, which is the lungs and the heart. The heart are found in this cavity. But below that, first you have a structure that separates this. So you have, what is it called?
Diaphragm.
Diaphragm. And then you have here abdominal cavity, which is called abdominal pelvis. Okay? But that cavity is called peritoneum. So the cavity is covered with parietal peritoneum. The organ is covered with visceral peritoneum. So can you tell me an organ that has got visceral peritoneum? The stomach. What else? Yes, the gallbladder, yes. The gallbladder. The liver. Anything in the abdominal cavity is covered with visceral pericardium. Okay. So on the posterior, we have cranial cavity, which is the skull that holds the brain, vertebral canal that holds the spinal cord. Thoracic and the abdomen are separated by the diaphragm. So there is a physical separation. I'm going to go back to the slide. But abdominal pelvic, there is no physical separation. There is no structure that separates the abdomen from the pelvis. But thoracic. thoracic and the abdominal pelvic are separated by the diaphragm. So you can see that thoracic, abdominal pelvic, you have a diaphragm, but there is no physical separation here. So this is the pelvic. So that's why this is called abdominal pelvic, abdominal and pelvic cavity. But what's the name of this abdominal cavity? Basically, you can assume all the structures we did, this three and this. If you put your hand into the glove, your hand will be covered, so that will be the viscera, and the outside will be the parietal. The space would be the serous cavity. So this is on the heart.